Good morning, God's beloved. We welcome you here this morning. I am Ron Routledge, Regional Minister for the Christian Church Disciples of Christ. And I bring you greetings and God's love from the 235 congregations across our region. I'm honored to be with you here today. It's, as you might imagine, not a normal kind of service. Emotions are on our sleeves, as it were. There's a lot of pain, there's a lot of hurt, and there's a lot of joy. And so as we gather to worship the living God, I'm reminded of Jesus, who said to his disciples one time, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." And so this is God's sanctuary, and it's a place where we can truly rest in God, and that's what we're going to do today. Even as we praise God and remember his promises to us, and as we lift up the life of Reverend Dr. Alan Miner. Welcome today. If there are any visitors here today, there's a little insert tear-off in the bulletin. If you would fill that out and put that in the offering plate when it comes by. And if you are a visitor, if you'd raise your hand, I think there's a gift for you. Are there any visitors here today? The church has a small gift for you. Any others? I feel very loved, and I hope you visitors do too. I'm a visitor with you, my first time here, and I'm hungry, so I might open this up about mid-sermon if you don't mind. It looks delicious. What a beautiful ministry. And I'm sure you do have a lot of visitors come through these doors, and what a joy it is to know the Lord, amen? What a comfort it is to know that this life does not end with death. But because of the victory of Jesus Christ, he has conquered sin and death. And he's assured us a place with him in heaven for all eternity. And so we come with our sadness, yes, but we also come in great hope, in great opportunity to participate in the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So let your hearts be welcome. Let your presence be made glad. For our God is a living God. And death never has the final word. Let us now enter into worship together.
I was asked to make one announcement, and that is this. Alex and Holly Segura, members here, or they come to our church, are getting ready to be members. She gave birth to a baby girl on May the 11th, so we're all excited about that. There are actually a couple of Lord's prayers in the Gospels. And the one that we're mostly familiar with, of course, is the Our Father who art in heaven. We all know that, can quote it. And we'll be doing so in this service. There is a prayer, another one from Jesus. Our Lord, And it wasn't necessarily teaching the disciples to pray like our Father. But this was an intercessory prayer from the Lord himself. And you can find this in the 17th chapter of the book of John. And during this call to worship here this morning, I want to briefly refer to that prayer. Right before Jesus was arrested, he was praying to the Father concerning those that he would leave behind. And it was apparent that during this intercessory prayer that he was very concerned about the apostles, the disciples, and what would become of them when he was called to leave. He knew that they were going to be confused. They were going to be distraught. And they were going to be heartbroken and even shocked. So he prayed this prayer. He said, Father, keep them by the power of your word and make them one, even as we are one. So the question that I have for all of us this morning is this: what does the Lord expect from us in times like these? We know that we're all different. We're individuals. So expectations are going to vary greatly among us. But there are a few things that the Lord himself made perfectly clear to us during his time here on earth. Over and over again, he expects us to love one another, to forgive one another, to hold one another up, and to bind together in the spirit of unity and the bond of peace. So please bow with me in prayer. Precious Heavenly Father, even though the heart of this body is broken, we enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. We honor you above all things, and we acknowledge the wisdom of God far above and beyond the wisdom of men. May the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest upon us all, and may this body of believers draw strength from one another. Bear one another's burdens as you intended it to be. Amen. And now at this time, let's all join together as we sing the songs of worship and praise. And please stand as we sing this beautiful hymn. Thank you.
Truly, it is well with our soul this day, O Christ. We remember those two wonderful words in Scripture that are so small and yet so meaningful, but God. Even though all seems hopeless and in despair, but God made a way when there was no way. When we stand at the grave of a loved one and it feels hopeless, but God opens up a way where there is no way. And so, because of that, and because all of your promises, Christ Jesus, are true, and yes, this day we proclaim it is well. It is well with our souls. And so, Lord, we come in your sanctuary, this place of rest. We're free to pour out our grief, our sorrow, our tears. For our beloved pastor has gone to be for all eternity with you. He's left the body for good. And we will miss him. But we thank you, O God, that in your wisdom and your mercy, you have prepared a place for him and a place for us as well. And so by the power of your Holy Spirit, I pray that you would come into our hearts and into our lives, that you would be close to the brokenhearted, that you would put your healing balm upon our souls, that you would care for us and comfort us by your tender mercies. Lord, we love you. We confess that there are so many things about this life we simply do not understand. We're simply not privy to the larger picture that you are, and yet we trust you because you have proven to be faithful to us over and over again, and so we love you. We believe, Lord, help our unbelief. But God, who is rich in mercy, sent his only begotten Son to take our place, to bear our burdens and our sorrows and our transgressions, that we through him might be made alive in this life and life forevermore. And so we praise you, O God, and we thank you, risen Christ, for showing us the way, for you faced death and dying boldly, courageously, and you conquered it. And so as we worship you this day, as we give you thanks for all of your promises, as we remember our beloved pastor, we ask that you remain close to us, that you give rest to our hearts. You reassure us of your love that never lets us go. We do pray all these things, even as our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
I asked Janet if she had any requests for today. And she said, Pastor Al, I'm sure would agree with me. Let's do something celebratory and loud. So let's stand. Dave's going to kick it off on the harmonica today. Ain't it just like the Lord?
Ain't
Wow, folks, that was good. Thank you, choir and Rod. And how about that David? He almost persuadeth me to want to learn how to play the harmonica. That was really good. It is time now for a very special and a very necessary part of our service, and that's the Holy Communion. The communion meditation this morning is going to seem just a little bit different to you, I'm sure. But just bear with me for a moment. One of the first lessons that we learned in high school, well, junior high, maybe before that now, I think it was junior high for me, was in the math class. We were learning how to deal with fractions. How many can remember having to fool with those fractions? My goodness. Drive you crazy nearly. You had to learn how to add, multiply, and divide fractions. Now, I'm getting somewhere with this, I promise. But if you remember, early on, we learned that fractions must be simplified in order to deal with them. For example, if you're adding a group of fractions, we learned early on that if we were going to achieve the correct solution to our problem, then those denominators, that bottom number of the fraction, they had to be alike in the equations. So the term common denominator was established and often used in your math. Well, so it is with us here this morning, all of us. We all have a common denominator. Now, we're disciples of Christ, and that brings us together. We all have different opinions and views. They vary greatly among us. And in almost every area of our lives, we're diverse people here. We have a lot of different ideas. If you don't believe us, go to some of the classes. But we all come under the umbrella of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now as we gather at this table today, we welcome all to join in with us in this great celebration of life and of death, but most importantly of all, of resurrection. So please join in this morning as we sing our communion hymn. And if you will, please stand on the second verse. Thank you.
When we gather at this table, we don't do so just us. We do it with all people in all times and all places. Revelation says they shall come from north and south and east and west and gather at the feast of God. That's what we celebrate here today, a celebration of life because of Jesus Christ. And so as we do, we remember when Jesus sat at table with his disciples. There he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it. And he gave it to them saying, "This bread is my body and it's given for you. Take and eat and remember me." And in the same way, after the meal, he took the cup and he gave thanks to God for it. And he gave it to those disciples saying, "This cup is the new covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins of many. Take and drink from it, all of you. And as you do, remember me." Let us pray.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless this bread, which symbolizes your broken body given for us. As we partake of this bread this morning, let us always remember the wondrous gifts provided to us because of your sacrifice. Because we've been forgiven, we must show forgiveness. Because we have received mercy, we must show mercy. And because you first loved us, we must show love to the world. And the prayer continues.
Father, we ask that you bless this wine and open the eyes of our hearts and let us truly see what you did for us when you died on the cross and rose again on the third day. Thank you for loving us and healing us. We remember the Lord, and we ask that you help us to never forget. In thy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Pastor Al would always comment on how thankful he was for the giving nature of the folks here at this church. And he would mention so many other churches he knew were struggling. Almost every finance committee meeting, he'd bring this up. He was so thankful. God has truly blessed us here at Branson Christian Church with many talented and gifted and generous people. And the resources that he has given us here are abundant. Now, those resources might be just your time. They could be ideas, talents, money, yes, and even encouragement and prayers for one another. And we, the people here at Branson Christian Church, it's our mission because we try to make a difference in our community. This church family right here today, this is a treasure that we all share. And we share in it equally. The assembling of ourselves together, it's a gift from God. And he intended it to be like that. He designed it in such a way that we might encourage and help one another along this journey that we're all on here today. So deacons, if you will, at this time, please come and receive the offering.
Loved. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last till the end of time. The only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another meadow. There are cornfields and wheat fields enough to grow. There are sunbeams and moonbeams enough to shine. Listen, Lord, if you wanna know. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just. Thank you.
Please bow with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, please accept these gifts that we bring before you today. We humbly ask that you use this offering according to your will. And may all things be done to the glory of God. Amen.
Two observations, being my first time here. It's the first service I've ever heard a harp and a harmonica in the same service. So that's really cool. I love the harp. So beautiful. And it's the first time in a long time that I've seen both offering trays completely filled. So kudos to you. Things have gotten pretty slim over the last couple of years in our churches, but apparently not here, as Pastor Al recognized. But then finally, just to look out upon you, to see your faces, to sense your spirits, to feel the love that you have for your beloved pastor, it's truly a joy to share this time today. I'm going to share three scripture readings, and we've tried to do hymns this morning that Pastor Al especially loved. The first is Psalm 90. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn man to destruction and say, "Return, O children of men, for 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, and like a watch in the night. You carry them away like a flood. They are like sheep. In the morning they are like grass which grows up. In the morning it flourishes and grows up. In the evening it is cut down and withers." One of Pastor Al's favorite scriptures, John 14. Jesus knows he's about to leave his disciples, and he says these words, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And finally, from the book of Revelation, "Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. And he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away.' Then he who sat on the throne said, 'Behold, I make all things new.' And he said to me, 'Write, for these words are true and faithful.' And he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give the fountain of water of life freely to him who thirsts.'" This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Today we celebrate the life of our loving and faithful Pastor Al, who served Branson Christian Church beginning in 2012. He went home to meet our Lord and Savior on May 14th. We honor his life and ministry today for his lifetime of service, which began early when he answered the call to ministry. His favorite verse in the entire Bible was Luke 4:18. "He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted." His favorite chapter in the Bible was St. John chapter 14. As we reflect on these scriptures, may they bring peace and comfort to each of you. You are the sermon this morning. The apostle said one time that you are the very letters that we write. And so it is your witness that is most important. It is your words, your experience of how you saw. I've done a lot of funerals. And I'm always asking the family, especially if I didn't know the individual, how did this person's life reflect the gospel of Christ? I don't have to ask that here today. But I do want you to speak these words. And so rather than a sermon by me, it's going to be a sermon by you. And I just want to invite some of you to come to the microphone over here and just share some words of remembrances as we celebrate Pastor Al's life and ministry here and all of God's promises. And his beloved Janet has agreed to be first to share. And after she's finished, anyone else that would like to share, please come forward.
You know, Alan told us in sermons that wherever we go, God's with us. And I know that God's with me right now. And I want to thank everybody that attended the visitation service and then went with us to Springfield. Al was buried at the VA cemetery with military honors, and it was beautiful. But at the beginning of the visitation, before we got there, I asked Al, I said, how do I do this? I don't know how to say goodbye. How do I do this? And he said, Janet Kay, you throw those shoulders back, you put a smile on your face, and you celebrate. And that's what we're doing. I just want to thank everybody for your support, for being here. And thank you, 2.5 years ago, you married us. Most of you were at the wedding. And I have to remind myself that, and I've prayed about this, that God, Alan is God's son. Alan belonged to God. And God loaned him to me for a wonderful 2.5 years. So, church family, my family, thank you for your love, your support, your prayers, and for blessing Al and I in our marriage.
Can we all just say together, we love you, Janet.
We love you, Janet.
Thank you for that courage.
Cindy. I just remember Al wasn't here when he first came, but have been quite involved since then. And there were, I'm reminded, and I think Johnie reminded us in his little thing about offering, was the three T's. His time. You know, he wasn't a 9-to-5 preacher here in an office. He was busy with his time, meeting with people whenever they could meet with him. He was using his vacation most recently. He told me it's going to be a workcation, and he was busy working on things for the elders and for the deacons and for the prayer warriors, so he kept right working through that vacation. And the time that he took, as each one of us individually would come up to him and say, Pastor Al, can I talk to you for a minute? If he didn't have that minute, he was ready with his little calendar to say, come in at this time. I miss last Monday morning. I was to have an appointment with him at 11, but he had better things to do. So I regret that I didn't get to talk to him then, but I did treasure the times that I had with him. Secondly, his talent. Now, I don't know if I could really say that he had a talent of telling jokes. But we did appreciate what he shared with us from time to time. But I was amazed at the talent that he had, that he wanted to make things and create things so that to give to others, to have for others. And that he was always questioning, well, how do I fix this problem? Or how do I, you know, and I know he had talked to a couple of guys over here and some others about a threshold in his house that he wanted to kind of fix. So he was always interested in that. And with his talent, I think he shared, oh my goodness, his genius. 2 degrees and not just a bachelor's. And all that he shared with the rest of us. And the fact that he even shared with us by serving our country. Wow. And then the final T was his treasures. His treasured smile. His treasured time. And I think most of all, the way he showed how he lived by that favorite verse. He was here to heal the brokenhearted. Never have I seen a man fulfill all three of these things. And from the congregation, I really appreciate all that he had done for us and shared with us. He was always seeking more information, very much so, on what we wanted to do. But most of all, he made each one of us feel so important to him. And I think that's why we are all here today. The last thing was, in the last few months, I remember he always said, don't go into anything alone. Make sure you have God with you when you go. And boy, God's been doing overtime for all of us recently. Bless you and bless this beautiful man that you shared with all of us. Dear Lord, thank you.
And I want to thank you, Cindy, for stepping into this gap as the chair here. And I spoke with her last Saturday morning, and she was in shock, as many of you probably still are. But she stepped up, and she's taken care of things that needed to be taken care of. And I know many others have, too. So thank you for all of your leadership. Please.
Well, you all wanted a poem. Many of you have called me. I'm in a sea of boxes. Keith's been in the hospital. I'm in a sea of boxes, and we've been there 5 weeks. So I thought, well, I can coast. They'll understand. So I just, up until 2 days ago, I really didn't think that this was going to go on for me. Because, number one, I couldn't find any paper. My computer hasn't been put up. And the only thing I could find was toilet paper and paper towels to write on. So I know Pastor Al would have enjoyed that. But my mother's in heaven, and she would not have. Characteristics. This isn't the poem. This is just some thoughts, real quickly. Oh, by the way, do you know about time? He got us out of here quickly, said what you had to say, and get gone. This is not going to be lengthy. Characteristics that made Pastor Al special. Number one, he put his Lord first. There was never any doubt. If ever he had a problem, first thing he'd say, we need to pray about it. He was right. And Cindy's already said, always available. You called him, or you said you had something on your mind. He'd said, I'll be there in a minute, and he was. He was our cheerleader. You know, we get down on ourselves. Of course, there's a little undertone sometimes. But he always told us how proud he was of us and what we were doing right. I never, ever heard him be critical. We should be like that, too. Always a jokester. And it is true. He had that sense of humor. We actually, when we first got Pastor Al, he was so prim and proper in his suit and everything. And we just thought he was going to be, you know, got all those little initials after his name. We just thought that's how he was going to be. Wrong. First thing he did in this congregation was tell a joke. But the one thing he stressed repeatedly over and over, and I believe that is why this congregation is so cohesive, and that is, he told us repeatedly, do not judge. That's God's job. And he didn't judge us. Now, I had a little humor here. Okay, what's Pastor Al going to need in heaven? Thought a lot about this. First of all, he just about didn't make it. He went right past St. Peter because he needed a compass and a map. I hope, Lord, that you did get in there. And he needs a volunteer team, he loved animals, to help build more kennels in heaven. Because he and Billy Graham both believe that because our pets are so important to us, they're going to be there too. I believe that. And there was a little bit awkwardness over at the place where they're making plates for the animals. The man producing them said, Max, don't you have anything original else to call your dog? Yeah, I have one still on earth, and her name's Maxie. We do need someone up there, Lord. We hope you've got him ready, that have been assigned to keep track of his keys, his eyeglasses, and his cell phone. They have laid in every place in this church. Lastly, Pastor requested of God to reside him next to Dunkin' Donuts. On a more serious note, now, this is really, isn't this lovely what I'm reading from? These are the words that were given to me about Pastor Al. What was the title? I don't know. I said he was our pastor, our mentor, and one of our dearest friends. We gather today to say goodbye to one of God's most special guys. Our hearts are broken and our tears keep falling, but our precious pastor has answered God's calling. He lived his life with fun and purpose, ignoring a very few who didn't appreciate the circus. He loved our church and all who are in it. When anyone called, he would be there in a minute. He taught us so much about love and prayer, preparing us one day to climb heaven's stairs. Remember Pastor Al in his earthly life. We cannot forget Janet, his devoted wife. She was the ray of sunshine that brought him completeness. She gave him so much, sharing her uniqueness. We're moving forward, armed with pastor's tools, reminding us to practice the golden rule. As he saw the lights of glory, he started running to his king, and he stood in awe as the angel sang. He heard the words that he longed to hear. Well done, my good and faithful servant. On earth you will no longer roam. You are my beloved child. Welcome home.
We have time for one more. Is there someone else that would like to come and share?
Okay, so 35 years into this, 9 pastors or full-time pastors or full-time interim pastors. Pastor Al was my favorite. what he was really, really good at was seeing what you needed, you know. And for me, I needed freedom, laissez-faire, and that was exactly what he gave me. I am remorseful that I didn't try to get closer to him, because just over the years, it seemed like I had to be careful with that, because I'd had 8 of them come and go before that. And it's kind of hard to let some of them go, and this was really hard. Pastor Al, thank you.
I think there was one more in the back that was going to come forward. Do you want to come and share, please?
Well, I really wasn't planning on saying anything, and then I just felt somebody push my shoulders. But some of you know this story and some don't. In 2010, I lost my high school sweetheart, the father of my children, and my husband of 43 years. And we used to vacation down here, so we moved here. I moved here in 2012. My husband passed away in 2010. I came to this church with a knot in my stomach, and I was familiar with the church because we had stayed in the basement one time because my son was a youth minister at the time, and we come down after the tornado and help clean up, and so they let us stay in the basement here. But I came to this church. I moved to Branson. I didn't know anybody, but I thought, I'm going to go to church. So I went to church, and I sat pretty much on the back row, and I got one of their little loaves of bread. On the tear-out sheet, it had a place that you could not only register, but what did you need prayer for? And I wrote, I am grieving, and I need a grief support group. The next day, on Monday, I got a phone call. It was Pastor Al. And he said, what's going on with you? And I told him my story. And he said, well, we don't have a grief support group, but we can sure start one. And so we did. And there were about a half a dozen of us. And we all grew so close. And one in particular that, of course, we always look forward to seeing was Miss Peggy. But she's passed away now and gone on up there, and she's probably there with Pastor Al. But anyway, he just, this church, and he saved me. They did. They saved me emotionally, and I needed it. And then just after Pastor Al's wife, Reva, passed away, we really got pretty close through email. We emailed because he was grieving, and I was further along in my grieving, and I was able to give him my point of view on things. And he also was decorating his house. And so he would send me pictures of areas and what he had and where do you think I should put it. about a week before he passed away, he was about church business, about elders, and he emailed me. And then I emailed him back about that. Then he emailed me back. And then he said, I've been on vacation for 2 weeks. He said, I've been sick the whole time. I'm on prednisone. And he said, but I'll live. And I thought, yeah, you are living. You're living in heaven, and you're living in our hearts. And I'll always refer to him as my quirky pastor. So thank you.
He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. Yes, yes.
I remember Pastor Al. I didn't come to Bible study, and he said, "Well, why don't you just come one time?" And I said, "Well, I don't know." And it just kind of stuck in my head. You know how he kind of just says something and it sticks in your head. And so I said, "Okay." And so I really liked it, and Bible study was just fun for me. So I come every time now, and it's just a fun place to go. But that's what he did for me. You know, it just was fun. And he always cracked the joke. I no matter how old he was, I'm always a minor.
I wasn't scheduled, but I hope I can share and be okay about that. We came about 3 years ago down here, and we came when Pastor Al was very happy because he had met Janet. And our and one of our first, well, probably maybe the second or third Sunday we came, they were getting married. And so we got to come to their wedding. And this whole church just embraced us. And we just felt like this was home. This is where we were supposed to be. And so Evan made reference to the Wednesday morning Bible study. And that's become so precious to us because we get to see Pastor Al twice a week on Sundays and then also on Wednesdays. And I just have to tell you, at first he said, well, I'm not going to share a lot about personal stuff, he said, because I want you guys to share. And, you know, as time went on, he started sharing more too. And it was just so nice. And the last Bible study that we had with him, he stood up and he said, I just want you to know, he said, that Janet and I have been married almost 3 years, he said. And I don't know where the time's gone, but it's just been so good. And it was just such a blessing for us to see him happy, because I know that he had his grieving times before when he had lost his first wife. But I want to tell you a little bit about Wednesday morning Bible study. It has just become a really a place where there is love, there is sharing. We learn about the Bible. We have a video usually from Andy Stanley that we watch, and then we kind of discuss afterward. But we share our good times and our hard times and our trials, and we just are there to support each other. We share birthdays. It's fun. So the last, this last Bible study time, this last week, when we did have Pastor Al with us, his temptation was always donuts, and you probably know that. So I went to Krispy Kreme, and we got a couple dozen donuts, and we set a cup of coffee and a donut on a plate right by Pastor Al's chair. And we all enjoyed our donuts, and we just know that he can eat as many as he wants now in heaven, and it doesn't matter, because he said he could eat a whole dozen. And I couldn't even believe that, but he said he could, so I don't know. But I just want, if you're in our Wednesday morning Bible study, will you just stand? And I just want you to see how many people have been touched by Pastor Al. So if you're in your Wednesday morning Bible study, just stand up. We've become a real group that cares about each other, that loves each other, and that will be there for each other. Thank you for standing. Something Pastor Al's always said, and it just stuck with me, is love God, love your neighbor, world peace. And I used to think, right, you know, and not everybody's going to do that. But, you know, if I do it, that's one more person. And if you do it, that's one more person. And so I've come to really hold that special in my heart from him. So we'll miss him on Wednesdays, but you know what? About a week or two ago, we were to the end of our lessons from Andy Stanley, and he went ahead and ordered four more kinds of lessons from Andy Stanley. And so he's got us in good stead. We'll be going for quite a while now. And it was just a blessing that he thought about that. You know, he just cared so much. He always said he was going to live to be 105 because he had stuff to do. He just, every morning, I'm on the clock. I just have a lot of things I want to get done. And I just, he's just so special to us and each one of us in our Bible study too. So I just want to say, Pastor Al, we love you, but we're so happy you're with Jesus. And that's where we want to be too. So thank you.
Wasn't that an awesome sermon? Let's have more like that, the people say. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I'll give you rest. And then the Hebrews writer says in Hebrews chapter 4, there remains then a Sabbath rest for the people of God. Make every effort to enter into that rest. And so from those two scriptures, we have rest for us who are carrying the burden of grief and loss. And we celebrate with Pastor Al that he has entered into God's Sabbath rest. So maybe he didn't take a vacation on earth, but he's got a vacation now with lots of donuts. And I'm going to steal that. Love God, love neighbor, world peace. I love that. That's awesome. I think that is possible. Yes. Let us pray together. What a joy it is, O God, to be in your house with your people. It is in this place that we have a lot of mountaintop experiences of baptisms and weddings, people committing their life to Christ. And we also have those moments of great sorrow, those valleys of shadows like death. And yet we're reminded that all of the promises of Christ are yes, and that he is our good shepherd who carries us through every dark valley, who leads us beside quiet waters and gives us rest. Lord, I thank you for your eternal rest that you've promised to each one of us. And so now, everlasting God, I pray that you might receive Al Minor into your loving arms. You created him. You redeemed him by the blood of your Lamb, and you sustained him moment by moment through your indwelling Holy Spirit. And so now receive one of your own child, with all of his strengths and all of his weaknesses. Receive him as he is, in that home that you've prepared just for him. And reassure each one of us of our home there as well. As we pass through this world, help us to be a light. Help us to not judge. Help us to love you and love neighbor. Help us to share our lives with one another. For truly, this is holy ground. And our hearts are filled and overflowing. And we thank you. In the beautiful name of Jesus, our risen Lord and Savior, all God's people said, amen. Amen. Will you stand as we sing together that beautiful hymn, Abide With Me? Let us be dismissed with God's blessing. And now, people of God, may our good Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and grant you peace. Go in the love and the knowledge that death never has the last word, but that through Jesus Christ, we share in his resurrection. May the power of the resurrection be yours today, tomorrow, and for all eternity. We praise you, O God. Abide with us. In the name of Christ, amen. And amen. Go in peace.